forget. So welcome everyone. This is our fifth and final webinar for this mini series. And we're going to look into holding space one-on-one, also do a little bit of a review of the other webinars, just to touch base in that area. So welcome. For those that are watching the video, welcome. And for those that are here, welcome, welcome. So happy to have you with us. Yvonne, do you want to ring the bell? Do you want to do the bell ringing? Do you want me to ring the bell? Got a bell here. There you go. I didn't quite come here, but I'm bell ready. Thanks. Go back to... If I turn on my original sound, okay, here's the challenge. If I turn on my original sound, you're going to also hear the rainstorm in the background. Let's see what that's like. All right. Well, welcome. I just invite you to sit in a way that feels comfortable and hopefully brings your body some ease and your mind some ease as we join together tonight. I'm gonna ring the bell and then I'll have some space and then I'll ring the bell again. And let's just use that time to touch into yourself, hear what's happening inside of you. You pay attention to your breathing if you'd like. Or just give yourself just a little chance to exhale and relax a little bit. Welcome. Welcome, welcome everyone. And welcome back, Yvonne, and welcome, Christine. So happy that you both could come. I'm going to start out tonight with a poem called I Came Seeking by Joan Stanford. And this poem is a to me really touch into the role that we can play when we're holding space for each other one-on-one. So, I Came Seeking by Joan Stanford. I came seeking medicine man, magician, mystic, miracle worker, myth maker, multi-talented, multifaceted messiah. I came seeking mother, mercy, merriment, moonsong, and meltdown. Instead, I find you, moving mirrors, mirror after mirror, mirrors manifesting magic, mystery, miracles. And I come to call you midwife as we labor together, birthing myself.
I will read that poem again. I came seeking by Joan Stanford. I came seeking medicine man, magician, mystic, miracle worker, myth maker, multi-talented, multifaceted messiah. I came seeking mother, mercy, merriment, moonsong, meltdown. Instead, I find you moving mirrors, mirror after mirror, mirrors manifesting magic, mystery, miracles. And I come to call you, midwife, as we labor together, birthing myself.
Thanks, Ivan. Thanks so much. And so we want to do our first check-in, just a little round of how are you arriving today? We had a little bit of a check-in pre-recording. but it would be nice just to hear from each person again. How are you arriving? And is there something from the poem that spoke to you? If there's anything from the poem that spoke to you. So I'm going to stop share so we can just see each other. And anybody can go first. We can do a popcorn invitational style. How are you arriving? And is there something from the poem that spoke to you? I'll put the piece in the center.
I came seeking a magician. Well, actually, you know that I work as a coordinator and as a principal in a school, so everybody think that you have like the all the answers. And then you just have to tell them sometimes, you know what? I don't have the answer either. So let's find out together. So I had to leave a situation today where I felt like, wow, why everybody wants me to be a magician and to have all the solutions? See, and I admitted that I don't have them, and probably I will have to need you to tell me what would be the best way to go. Right. So I resonate with that part of the poem. I say, being like a miracle worker, but in fact, sometimes people have this high expectation of you, and it's okay also because the bar is high, and then you have to be working on in yourself to meet that standard. But it's okay if you don't have the answers a day like what happened today. And I felt humble and I said, okay, let's find out.
I'm taking the talking piece. I came today seeking mercy, I think. There's been a lot of noise in the nation here in Australia with the referendum that will be happening next weekend, and there's a lot of discordant voices. And this last 24 hours particularly, I've felt I've needed to be quiet and close those noises for at least 24 hours before I step back into the fray. And what came to me in this poem was, I come to call you midwife, as we labor together, birthing myself. That's really spoken to me, and in what this space is too, and has become in holding space. So thank you.
I think I come expectant of our time together. As all of the things that are happening, this is a time to just not think about everything that's going on in the country or other things that I have to do. But just to learn from each other. I'm really looking forward to this hour and to this hour that we have. And one of the parts of the poem that resonate with me is the moving mirrors. And I think that, you know, with life, that's what we find. We have plans, and we have expectations, but we will find those moving mirrors, and we don't know how things are actually looking, and they are changing. But after all, this is what we're here for, right? Like, to learn how to deal with transition, with ourselves, with others. And so, yeah, that part really resonated with me. And I'm looking forward to this time with you all.
I am arriving a little tired, a little weary, but also energized at the same time. We had a group of 30 high school students, eighth graders, so 15 year olds here today. And I was reminded of the joy of just little tiny moments like this. We were walking on the land and this young student just worked so hard to get out a question, to ask me a question in English. And she was so proud of herself that she said it and understood my answer. And, you know, I think about holding space one-on-one, and it's also in those little moments that might seem like, so Asu, in our other world, we do a lot of work with language teachers. In English language teachers and students. So these were English students that had a special field trip to come visit us today. So just holding space, but being able to just be present and hold space for her, this young 14-year-old, as she was really like trying to say, why did you live in Costa Rica? You know, it was hard for her to say it, and she did it, you know. So I'm sort of sitting in that energized joy and also feeling a little tired. And the poem for me, this I really love those last two lines. I like, labor together, birthing myself. I just think that's, if I can, you know, witness this young woman birthing herself as an English speaker in this one little moment in her life where she just hasn't had an opportunity to do that before. And she has genuine curiosity and her genuine self is coming up. I think that's pretty powerful. So, and it's pouring rain again, so. Lots of beautiful earth energy here today. I will put the piece back in the middle.
I pick up the fucking piece. And I came speaking, nothing specific, but with the conversations sort of tonight, today, before the recording started, it's just found the miracle of connections and, you know, humanity, what we are facing, the challenges we're facing, and opportunities for us to hold space one-on-one. That was beautiful to experience that miracle manifested in our conversations. And I'm arriving a little bit tired. It's been a really hot this week. And I'm excited with a connection with students. I was with Mary this morning with the high school students and teachers. It was so energetic for me to be like back in the classroom with students with questions about life, questions about, you know, what's next. So, thank you so much for the opportunity to connect with you. If you're watching this recording, it's been a great experience to be with you these five webinars. Put a talking piece back in the center.
And we lost Christine. So we'll move forward. Let's move forward. I'll share the screen again. Wait a second. Let me make sure I have. Oh, I've lost it. Technology. I'm also arriving a little bit in awe of technology still. Oops, that's not what I wanted to do. That's gonna run too. So just to do a quick little review of the webinars, this is our fifth and final webinar, so we're celebrating that. In the first one, we talked about the basics of holding space, and we talked about liminal space, holding space, and hijacking space. Well, just three basic concepts of this. And I'm not sure if you all follow Heather on social media, but she's been doing some interesting posts now about liminal space and exploring more of like what is that liminal space, that middle ground between not knowing, from knowing something to not knowing, to becoming something else and knowing something else, being something else, and that transition. And so the idea of holding space that we're accompanying people through as they're journeying through some kind of liminal space. And I've been thinking about liminal space in little ways, like there can be a liminal space when you go to a restaurant. This sounds really superficial, but it's true. You go to a restaurant, I go to a restaurant, and I sit down and I look at the menu and I don't know what I want to eat, right? And I put myself in a liminal space of like, what am I going to try and figure out what I'm going to eat? And I have to make a decision, and eventually I'll come out of that liminal space and having made a decision about what it is that I'm going to eat. That's like a superficial, perhaps, or tiny little liminal space in life. And at the same time, if someone is trying to hijack my space, it can turn into something really significant. If somebody's like, Mary, just make a decision. You always take too much time, or, you know, to come in saying you should eat this because you always like that. So, you know, it could be a small example, but I've been thinking a little bit about that too. Like, what are some little liminal space experiences that help me build capacity in understanding liminal space and holding space and hijacking space? Anything else anybody would like to add about these three terms or the basics? Any questions? Okay. In the second webinar, we talked about holding space for ourselves. And there's a lot of different concepts for each of these. We're just going into a few, and I think we went into universal human needs, tenderness, and authenticity. And we talked a little bit about each of those and how they help us build capacity to hold space for ourselves. Anything else in this webinar too that somebody would like to ask or comment about? Add, Yvonne, do you want to add anything?
We remember, and we did the connection with a Rosenberg theory about nonviolent communication. We found that universal needs are important when you want to understand your feelings, right, and to promote empathy with yourself and the others. And it worked together very well. Sometimes people might confuse like Rosenberg nonviolent communication with holding space, but holding space is a little deeper, right? It's what we have explored. And for example, the liminal space, that was a concept that I really found very interesting, and we have had moments in our life. Actually, every 7 years, I have like a liminal space on. Something happened that I'm transitioning to another stage of life. And we can understand better people when we are identifying their needs too. Yeah, we can hold their space better.
Yeah. Yeah, I think compassionate communication, Marshall Rosenberg's work, is a part of holding space. That it's definitely a skill that I can use when I'm holding space, for sure. And it's a vision of who we are as humans that really helps me hold space. Remember, you know, having a way of really understanding our shared humanity. That's for me. Thanks, Elise. Anybody else? So in the third webinar, we looked at the circle way, right? And holding space in groups and what it takes to create something like this, some kind of circle, and the work of the circle of Christina Baldwin and others in terms of creating ways, the mechanisms for us to hold space for each other in groups. And then the last webinar, we looked at holding space in complexity. And specifically, we looked at safe space, brave space, and then seeking and honoring sovereignty. We didn't go into all of these, but that was really, and we also used these images to like, how do we envision complexity? So yeah, it was really nice. And tonight, well, before we go on to that, those was a little review. Just another second little check-in. How has holding space come into your thoughts or words or actions recently? Or has anything that we've been touching on come alive for you in any particular way, or any comments you want to make on how this has showed up in your life?
Well, more often and often, I have to hold space for people. I don't know, and I see with my poem face of you know, I have found many people in needs of being understood, or you know, that I'm just there, and I feel also really satisfied about the chance to help, to contribute, just to be there. So I more and more often I find somebody that I need to listen and relax and to create a safe space for this person. So believe it or not, I'm becoming like more empathetic, like, oh, he needs a space. Okay, I'm ready.
I feel that for me, I've been just very aware of how, like, holding space, for example, in the relationship that I have with my mom, and also some transitions that I'm going through. Yesterday I had a really interesting conversation with my mom, and about, we were planning a birthday celebration. And so, like, I had other ideas, but my mom was just like really with the idea of like celebrating it at her place. And I was like, yeah, let's do that. And she was just so like empowered, and like I had not seen her like that. Like, I've been able to see her through a process of growth and empowerment and making decisions on her own. And it felt really good to like throughout the recent months to just have been, you know, there for her and just listening to her, and like not saying like, oh, you should be doing this or you should be doing that, but rather just holding space for her and listening to her. And you know, if she asks for support, then I'm there. But it was just really beautiful yesterday to see her like take the lead on organizing this celebration. And I was just so proud of her. And I think she was very happy with herself too. She was like, she said something like, oh, yeah, I'm going to ask your brother to do this, and if you can bring this, and your other brother could do that. And I was like, okay, yeah, yeah, let's do it. And so I was just thinking about that, about how I've been able to hold space for her, to just listen, to be available. And not have to go into my usual mode of trying to fix things and trying to control things. it felt like such a huge success for her, like for her and for me. So yeah, I just wanted to share that it was really beautiful yesterday to see her like become empowered and kind of be on the other side of the transition, I feel.
I've been receiving a gift of holding space for someone in my family who has been in a liminal space for the last few weeks. And one new experience I had is just being. At the beginning of the process, I wanted to do and cognitively use the information I have and do what will be the next step or the best concept to work with, like the universal human needs or complexity. What is one thing I need to do? But the more I've been into practice and with this gift of, you know, receiving this gift of practicing holding space, it's just the essence of being. That's been a great gift for me, saying it's just being, and then following my intuition, my wisdom, and love that is coming from inside. So being is so powerful and it's transformative. I just wanted to share with you that. Thank you.
I'm just emerging from 2 months of holding space for others. In August, it was community. And in the last month, the 4 weeks of September, it was family. So for a full month, there was family coming and going and coming and going and coming and going. And so the holding space for myself, I was taken aback. I was just going for my annual GP checkup, and blood tests came back a little bit odd. So it's been a real confrontation almost in, oh, wow, how did this happen? And now to this has come at a really good time, holding space one-on-one. You know, what is it that I've missed in all of this about holding space for myself with what's happened over the last 8 weeks? So, yeah. Thank you.
Just want to say welcome to Myrna and welcome to Karin. I'm happy to have you both here. And I think, Karin, this is maybe your first time with us.
Yes, indeed. I was invited by Paola. And I am, hi, Paul. I'm very grateful for having this space to reflect and to learn about you all. I believe as humans and as teachers, it's always important to learn from one another. And even if I just got here, thank you for admitting me.
No, oh, happy to have you here. Welcome. And welcome, Myrna.
And thank you so much, Mary. Thank you, everybody. Yeah, I'm missing this moment. So I'm so happy and thankful to be here.
Well, let's dive into today's theme here a little bit. And so I'm going to pass it over to Yvonne. Yvonne, do you want to share from your computer?
I'm good. You share. That's good. Okay. Is that okay for you?
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you. I love this quote from this American educator. Listening is so powerful. What is listening? It's a magical and strange thing, a creative force. when we really listen to people, there is an alternating current, and this recharges us so that we never get tired of each other. We are constantly being recreated. Love this quote about listening. So using this quote, I'm using these two questions from Heather. She posted this a long time ago. She posted these questions on Facebook, asking people this question on what listening is and what listening involves. So what do you think are the best indicators if someone is listening or not listening? So you can share, you can open your mic, or you can share in the chat too, and put the talking piece in the middle.
Yeah. Thank you. I think for me personally, the indicator are people's size, because when someone can have eye to eye contact with you, but they're following, you know, what you're saying, but they're not really listening. So there is a different upside, different spark in their eyes when someone is really listening to you, to me. I mean, that's the way I feel it. Even though they can provide some kind of you know, active listening, like they said, or some kind of feedback saying, oh, yeah. But they're not actually, as I said, they're following, but they're not actually listening. And it is that's the way I would say, you know, that happens face to face, at least for me. Thank you.
For me, it's when I see people who are nodding and they have a smile of a happy day. Like, I genuinely feel that that person is connecting with me. When it's not, when people are using their cell phone and trying to be connected with you at the same time, and you don't feel like a touch.
That's so interesting. Go ahead.
Thanks, Ivan. To me, it's words of empathy. The fact that they are somehow processing what you're saying and can identify with what you are feeling. And also the questions that they might ask, like how, you know, how, like moving forward, like, what are you thinking? Or how did you feel? Or, oh, that's a shame. But, you know, questions that they might ask related to what you said, I feel that are two indicators.
Right. So it sounds like we need to show that we have a deep connection with each other. And it's manifested through our body, you know, like a body language, like eye contact, the type of questions we have asked, the follow-up questions, and the nodding. There's something saying, yes, I'm here, I'm present, and I'm with you. Yes, that's so interesting. Yeah, thank you for sharing. Well, today we'll be talking about different types of listening. Oh, Karen.
Sorry, I would add that that someone is genuinely listening to you is that not only empathy and nodding and eye contact, but it's also about not having prejudices or trying to fill in the sentence you have not yet finished, or trying to accelerate the pace of the conversation, or people who are, I mean, you see in their eyes and in their body language, you are able to identify that they are listening to answer. I mean, they are not listening to understand. They're listening just to get an answer and get rid of the conversation. So in those cases, it is normally better to keep the conversation very superficial, so that it ends to the other person as he or she wishes.
Right, that's kind of a type of listening. So when I listen in for myself, it's about me, it's about my stories, about my thoughts, about my beliefs, right? But I'm not listening, it's just about me. Well, thank you, Karin. All right, so we'll be talking about four types of listening. This is referring to the work of Heather. And I'm gonna tell you a little story about, so describing and using the four types of listening. The first one is just about me, my judgments, my habits of listening. So when I have my wife come in and say, hey, do you have a minute? I would like to share something that is important to me, and I would like to have a conversation with you. I mean, I just hear working on my desk, and I immediately in my head is like, oh my God, what is she trying to purchase? What is she trying to talk to me about? What happened maybe with the girls? So maybe she's trying to a plan. Maybe she saw a place she wants to go for vacation, and she wants to make a plan for December, but it's just in my head, but I'm not listening. This is downloading. It's just my opinion, my judgments. So it's not deep connection, it's just about me. But if when I go to the facts, the second level of listening, so the deeper I go, the more risky, the more challenging, the more vulnerable I am. So, and then the second one is just listening to the facts. It's just a fact, oh, she's asking for some time and she has something important. And she's taking the time to ask and invite me to share or do something together. It's just a fact. You see the change a little bit now, it's going deeper. It's, I open my mind and I'm flexible and open, say, oh, okay, it's an invitation. Let's see. And then I can go deeper. I can go deeper and I can connect with the emotions, the experiences she's having, right? From her perspective, and saying, wow, it sounds as exciting to you. I see your eyes and I see that I can feel the energy. You're coming with an invitation. Maybe you, whoa, what's going on, right? So it's something important. I see it's important, something you value. And I value that you're sharing that with me. So I'm going deeper into not me, my head, my opinion, my beliefs, my judgments, but into what she is experiencing. So I'm connecting to her essence and what I see from the outside, you know, her body language saying, this is important to me and I want to invite you to work together. And then the last level of listening is a generative listening. And this is an opportunity to make a change. So this is an opportunity to understand or create a space so I can have full attention to what is emerging and to what is manifested. And it might be different. It might be different, but it's just connected to what is coming and accepting and receiving what is coming, what has been manifested. So there's change here, and I'm changing everything, my opinions, my judgments, my thinking. And then, so I not open my will and my heart, but I open my will. Not on my mind, my heart, but my will. I'm willing to accept and receive and change everything. We're going to be practicing the next exercise. We'll be practicing, but I would like to see Now, as I lend to you the four type of listening that Heather refers to in her work, Holding Space. Thank you for the emoticon, Paola.
Yeah, no, I love the idea of the open mind, open heart, and open will. It's just very easy to remember. And as you're having a conversation, like thinking about that, like to have an open mind, to have an open heart, and an open will. So that's very helpful.
I think it's interesting to think about listening from a source. Where is that in me? And what is it like just to be listening from that place, which is so different than like listening from my head for information or listening from my ego to want to defend or support myself. But just that listening from source, yeah, I'm thinking a lot about what does it take to connect with source before I start listening so that I can be listening from that source.
Yeah. I love that idea, Mary. So connected from the source of love. And I love that idea. Before listening, I'm connected to the source, love. And then I listen from love. I love it. All right, let's move on to practice, Mary. We're going to be working in breakout rooms, and these are the instructions for the practice. So maybe if you have a chance to take a screenshot, we'll be sharing the screen too. You can take a screenshot also. So there are three stages in this practice. Before, while listening, and after listening. In the before stage, so the two will be working in pairs. One is a listener and the other one is a speaker. So we both, the listener and speaker, take 30 seconds and then follow steps two and three. Take a few slow and deep breaths and prepare your heart and mind to engage. That's the first stage. Just the preparation before listening or asking the question. So you decide who will be the listener first and who will be the speaker first. And then on the second stage, you ask two questions. And you can use these questions. We have two questions as a reference, or you can use the questions that is alive in you and you want to ask. So when you ask the question, after the speaker asks the question, take a pause for the listener, for the speaker to answer the question. And when the question is answered, so the listener offers gratitude. Might be a thank you, might be something else expressing gratitude, might be body language. And we ask this question different times. Heather, ideas is to ask this question 9 times. So you go deeper and deeper and deeper. Every time the question is asked, I go deeper in the answer, looking from inside, the answer from inside. And that's my experience when I'm being asked a question. First answer is coming from here. And then I go deeper and deeper and deeper answering the same questions. And then the same thing for the second question. You ask the question. Take a pause for the answer. And when the answer is given, offer gratitude. That's a while asking and answering question stage. And then the last stage, after asking and answering, it just process experience. Again, we have some questions, but you can use any question that emerges to process experience. And when we come back from breakout rooms, we will be harvesting the experience and see how was that practicing generative listening 101. Questions for the instructions.
How long does it, will it take for, I mean, every time we switch, or I mean, in between every, each of the nine times, how long should we wait for the speaker to speak and us listening?
That's a good question. Follow your intuition. Yes, follow our intuition. And if there's no further answer, I would say that will be the end. I don't have to ask nine times. Might be five, six, three, four, or nine times. It's just to go deeper. Maybe in the second, third questions, I go deeper and that's enough. I'm complete with that question. That's the answer I have. An experience is just listening and listening and listening. And we talked about what listening is and involves. So we're just practicing a type of listening. And we're going to have 20 minutes. Can I offer a suggestion,
Ivan? I think we can have 10 minutes. So if we have 10 minutes, you'll have 5 minutes for each person. And we'll send a message when it's time to switch and sort of whatever you've reached in that. Is that okay? So you have 5 minutes for each person, then maybe 2 or 3 minutes for processing, and then we'll bring you back. And we'll send you some time message. Is that okay for you, Ivan?
Yeah, that's okay. That's great. That's a great idea.
Okay. So I have all the rooms set up. So if anybody doesn't have, there's no other questions, we'll send you off to practice generative listening. We had someone drop off. Let's see.
I don't know if you need to be. Oh, let me. Oh, I cannot pause the recording. Welcome back. Thank you. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Ready for a bell?
Thank you, Mary, for a bell.
A little transition back from our small groups to our big group.
Thank you for the bell. I'm curious about what you noticed when practicing generative listening. How was that for you as a listener and a speaker?
I worked with Mirna, and it was fabulous. I mean, it was a fabulous feeling. Listening with an open mind and an open heart and open will. Even if this was the first time I met her, I was able to open my heart and share fears and wants. And she was open as well. And in the end, we discovered things we share in common, even if we have never met one each other before, and it was to me it was relieving. It's like I'm not the only person in the world with these fears, and to listen to her I learned about her as a human being without all the pressure that we normally have when we listen to others. Like, I listen because I need to comply with this document or because I want someone to carry or I have to achieve my goals. So it was relieving to listen to a human and connect at the human level. So thank you, Mirna.
For me was, first of all, I noticed somebody actually listening. Like I said, you know, the spark in the eyes. And even though we are here, I can see it. And not only that, I can feel it. And like she said, you know, I'm not the only one in the boat. So we're kind of rowing in the same direction, right? And somehow we're partners in this challenges or that we're facing. And when I was listening to her, for me, it was motivating, was inspiring. You know, I said, wow. Yeah. And that for me is very healthy. So, Karen, thank you so much for sharing and appreciate it.
I found that it wasn't long enough as an exercise. I shared this, Paolo, that in asking that question of what do you want, I wanted to ask it numerous more times to go deeper into finding out more about Paolo. And also I found for myself when that question was asked, when Paolo asked the question of me, you know, what are you afraid of? Even though I knew that question was coming, I was still thrown and taken aback by the power of it. And particularly because the space that Mary and Ivan have created here, this container of trust and vulnerability, that I knew that I could answer it deeply, but I felt incredibly moved by it. And it struck me that if we're stepping into this space, time is very fluid in holding space. It's incredibly fluid. So so thank you for the exercise. It was really profound, and thank you, Paola. Thank you so much. And thank I'm totally you. Mispronouncing your name. I'm sorry.
No, you're good. No, thank you. I was telling Sue that one of the things that I was that I thought about as we were processing the exercises that, I mean, I knew it was a listening exercise and that I was going to listen and also speak, but the fact that I knew that the other person was listening to me, that I didn't have to like guess if she was going to listen to me, that was her role. It felt very freeing and relieving because I knew that the person was really going to listen to me, and it opened up a space for vulnerability to take place. And so it's really powerful to know that if you are a listener or if the other person is a listener, that there is a lot of power in you being a good listener, listening with an open mind, heart, and will, because it really sets the other person, it gives the space to the other person to be free and vulnerable. So thank you, Sue.
Thank you. One thing that I experienced while I was asking Christine, I was with Christine, when she answered the question, I was feeling where I was receiving and what part of my body was receiving the answer. And it was so beautiful to feel all around the answer I was hearing. Yeah, that's so beautiful. And when I was asked, I was a speaker. I heard the question, but I wanted to find an answer within. not wanting to just say it, you know, like I want to answer the question. I just wanted to. So I was just taking some time, and I gave an answer, but then I say, no, that's not the answer I'm feeling from inside. So take it. I took some time and then say it again, because I wanted to, you know, come from inside. So that was a great experience. And with Christine, thank you so much for the exercise. Wow, thank you. And I pass it over to Mary. Thank you.
Well, welcome back, Awilda. Happy to see you again, have you back with us. We made it home safe and sound. And Christine, did
I'm
you?
I'm sorry I lost the practice, but I'm just listening how nice it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can try it again sometime for sure. All right. Christine, is there anything I just want to open up if you don't have to, but if there's anything you wanted to share? I wasn't sure if you were.
Thank you, Mary. Yeah, I'm still kind of struggling with internet here. I'm watching Marley at her gymnastics, and she just did a logro. So, and she hasn't done a logro in probably, I don't know, a few months now. So just here, sitting here right at this, she's on bars, and so she was able to do a thing or leave. Well, anyway, it was very cool. So you probably saw my face.
Expression,
kind of. That's
exciting. How fun!
I'm not being as mindful as I should be for this for this discussion. But I oops, are you still there? Yeah. So I very much enjoyed the exercise with Ivan, and I did feel that level of trust and confidence to share. And as we did start getting deeper. Even though I knew what the questions were and they felt very innocuous, it did trigger some emotion in me, which was kind of relieving, giving of relief. So I very much appreciated that opportunity to dig deeper and kind of answer questions that I've been trying to answer maybe too much superficially. And it was giving me a chance to go deeper, and one doesn't have that opportunity very often. So I'm very thankful, grateful for the time with Ivan and for you providing this. Thank you, Mary.
Great. Well, thank you all. Well, another aspect of Holy Space One-on-One, which we're not going to go into, but we thought about it, is the drama triangle. And it's something that we do go into in the Foundations program, but these roles that we play that are actually not very effective sometimes, and then an anecdote to that, which is the empowerment dynamic. So you can look at these in the slides if you want. You can Google them and look them up. But it's another aspect of holding space one-on-one, which is really powerful to become aware of. But I want to share with you as we finish up, and I think you all have seen this too. There's other learning opportunities if you're enjoying learning about holding space. We have the it's the module 5. This is module 5 of the Foundations program. Heather has an ongoing course and community called the Full Bodied Life. Next year she'll have Know Yourself, Free Yourself. We're actually not going to have the retreats. We need to take that out. She has a ebook that is free on a website called The House That Tenderness Built, which is really beautiful. And she has a book that's coming out in January, Where Tenderness Lives, on healing, liberation, and holding space for oneself. And of course, her original book as well, The Art of Holding Space. So those are all things that are open to you all, open to us. And so if you want a little more, there is some more for you. Yeah. So thank you all so much. As we wrap this up today, this is our last session in the mini series. Maybe we can do a little checkout circle of just what's something that you're leaving today with or leaving the series with, either one. I'd love to hear a little checkout, a brief checkout.
living with that, that I want to learn more. But I feel like I'm in diapers. So it is like, oh, where do I go just to go to the beginning so I can understand better?
I'm leaving with a lot of gratitude for having learned about holding space and just how practical it is to include it in my life. And also for having the opportunity to share with all of you. I've learned so much from everything that everyone has shared, just your humanity and how just the wonderful human beings that all of you are. So I'm really grateful for having had this chance to have shared these. I know I haven't been to all of the webinars, but I think most of them. But it's been great. Thank you. Thank you, Mary, and thank you, Iman, for just being wonderful facilitators.
Well, I feel very thankful, really, for this wonderful opportunity that Iman and Mary created for all of us. It definitely is something new that will be remaining in my mind and heart. Like, for example, liminal space, understanding when you are, when somebody else is in the liminal space, the concept of holding space for somebody, to be that person that can help others, right? In another way, you don't have to advise, you don't, it's just being there, right? And I take from tonight that there are listening levels. That's something that I find it very interesting. I can understand probably the first two very well, but then the generative listening, I don't know, I will have to go deeper. So I go with the homework. And thank you very much, Mary. I love you, really. You have been my mentor in many different levels. So every time you invite me, I feel like blessed, really. Thank you very much for being the light in many lives. You don't even know your impact. So we appreciate your light in this world. This world is better because you are there. Everything is about Mary. Thank you, Iván, also. Great, great presentation. Thank you.
I have great gratitude for being in this space and having the opportunity. And thank you to Mary and Iván for creating this beautiful container that we could share. And I'm leaving with very excited about stepping into the Foundations course, which starts very soon. So a bit excited. Thank you.
I'm living with gratitude and excitement to see what's next.
Well,
I'm leaving with feeling, sorry, Mary, just real quick. I'm feeling very satisfied, very with new knowledge, and of course, very, very grateful for the work that the two of you are doing, and the connection with Heather has really been so impactful for so many people. And so thank you very much for all the work that you do. We love you very much.
And I'm living with the joy the connection brings to my life. Thank you so much to all the participants who joined in this webinar series, the ones that are watching the recording. If you're watching the recording, you were here and you're watching the recording, thank you so much for the opportunities to co-create space and learn from each other and connect deeper and deeper. Thank you very much.
I'm leaving with a lot of gratitude as well. Thank you so much for the love and the gratitude. Thank you for coming and for really exploring this work together. I think it makes the world a much better place. Yeah, it makes my personal world a better place for sure. So, Ivan, thank you for all the collaboration that we've had. And Sue, excited to see you in the Foundations program. It's going to be fun. And also the rest of you, look forward to seeing you. Wilda, I'm going to the Dominican Republic in November, so I hope to see you then. No, surprise.
Let's have this coffee together.
Yes, time for cafecito. And I wish you all the best. And for the people that are watching, also wish you the best. And we'll let you know when some other little mini series comes up as well. We'd love to have you with us. And may holding space be a blessing in your life. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Good day, good night, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, Paola.